I often get asked by my patients, what causes IBS? Why am I having this now? I never used to have any of these problems. IBS can be frustrating. It's a diagnosis of exclusion, meaning you've had symptoms probably for a while and looked for other causes, and since nothing's turned up, now we're going to call it IBS. I'm Betsy Yelmgren, registered dietitian with Feed to Succeed. Today we're going to talk about some of the underlying factors of IBS and what can cause flare-ups. Getting to a diagnosis of IBS can be a long journey. It starts with a little bit of gas or bloating or constipation. It doesn't seem like much, but it can persist, be ongoing, and it can be hard to know if this is a problem. Everybody has these things once in a while. It can be really easy to write this off with kids. What we do know is when your symptoms are happening at least once a week or more for a period of 3 months or longer, then we think it's time to take another look. Once you determine that there is a problem and you go to see the doctor, they're going to be looking for different diseases. They might take blood, they might do some scopes, and what they're looking for are things like celiac disease, Crohn's disease, maybe colitis, or EOE. When we've ruled out all these things, what ends up happening is that we call it IBS. So IBS, therefore, is a diagnosis that means we don't really know what it is, it's none of these other things, and we're going to call it IBS. So where does this leave you? Now you have a diagnosis, but there's no medications to treat it. Do you just have to live with the symptoms? Fortunately, we know a lot about the causes and the triggers, and you don't have to just live with the symptoms. We do know that maybe 10 to 15% of people worldwide struggle with IBS, and there is no medication to treat it. That doesn't mean you just have to live with the symptoms. We do have theories about some of the causes of IBS, and we do know some things about what triggers it. That gives us some options on how we can treat it. Let's talk about some of the causes of IBS. One cause is dysbiosis. Dys means bad, and biosis means mode of life. So when we take that word, a bad mode of life, what we're referring to are the bacteria, the microorganisms that live in our stomach, in our gut. There's a balance between the good and the bad, and when that gets disrupted, that's when we would say this person has dysbiosis. Some examples of what might cause that would be if you get a viral illness or a bacterial illness that changes the bacteria in your gut, that could cause some dysbiosis. Similarly, treatments with various antibiotics can kill off good and bad bacteria and change the balance that way. Other things that can affect dysbiosis would be the environment, changes in temperature, changes in location, and also we can see some dysbiosis from the foods we're eating because the bacteria in our gut feed off the foods that we eat. So sometimes dietary changes or new foods can change the balance of bacteria as well. We have also seen some studies that have indicated that people with IBS have a different balance of bacteria in their gut than people without IBS. IBS has also been associated with inflammation in the gut. When inflammation occurs, we get an increased number of immune cells. And these immune cells trigger proteins called cytokines to be released. The cytokines cause inflammation, and while inflammation can be a good thing, it also can be bad when it triggers pain, digestive cramping, and bloating. Pro-inflammatory cytokines may have a role in our body's response to digestive pain and discomfort, and we do see this in people with IBS. IBS has also been associated with increased intensity and frequency of intestinal muscle contractions. This is why we get rumbling in our stomachs. But it seems like for some people with IBS, they're feeling these rumblings and these digestive cramps a lot more forcefully. This can affect motility, meaning how quickly food moves through our digestive system and creates a bowel movement. If you have a lot of muscle contractions, the food may move through quickly and you might get cramps or discomfort. But slow muscle contractions might make things move more sluggishly, and you might see some constipation from that. And lastly, we know that the gut-brain axis has an effect on IBS as well. The gut and the brain are closely intertwined, and we see this in things like stress and anxiety when it presents with stomach issues. You can see this in kids, and sometimes it gets labeled as IBS. in terms of reducing and avoiding triggers, we know that maybe up to 75% of IBS is related to food intolerances. So we certainly can control what we put in our mouths. And how we feed our body is going to influence the bacteria in our system, how they grow and how they thrive. Additionally, controlling stress and anxiety may also help reduce symptoms. Some patients may benefit from anti-anxiety or antidepressant medications. And there's other things we can also do to control depression and stress, such as acupuncture and meditation and hypnosis. These are all things that are worth looking into to control IBS symptoms. The most common cause of food-related IBS is due to what we call FODMAPS. FODMAPS is an acronym that stands for fermentable oligo, di, monosaccharides, and polyols. And these are starches and sugars that are fermented by the bacteria in our gut when we eat them. By reducing FODMAPS, we're effectively reducing the amount of fermentable food the bacteria in our gut can use to produce their symptoms. So by going on a low FODMAPS diet and reducing the food supply to the bacteria, most people can greatly reduce their IBS symptoms. It is important to meet with a doctor first. You do need to rule out any underlying diseases. If you've had multiple tests, tried different medicines, and still gotten unsatisfactory results, it's time to try a low FODMAPS diet. A low FODMAPS diet is done for a short amount of time, usually 2 to 6 weeks. You either feel better or you don't. But if you feel better, this is going to give you a lot of information about your body and about your food and about the things that trigger you. If you don't feel better, that's also useful to know because then you know your IBS isn't food related. Either way, it's a great next step. While we don't know the exact cause of IBS, we do know a lot of information about the digestive system and what triggers IBS. Understanding the triggers of IBS gives us a lot of options in terms of what we can do to reduce or alleviate symptoms. If you want to know more, subscribe to our YouTube channel. Over the next few weeks, we'll be bringing you more videos and resources to help parents and kids learn to flourish and control their IBS symptoms.